Hello everyone, welcome to today's live webinar, MEA assays of synaptic transmission and plasticity for decision making in CNS programs. My name is Diane Royer. I am the marketing manager at Neuroservices-Alliance, and I will be moderating today's webinar. This event is the second of a series of live webinars. Each of them features one or several of our neuroscientist experts and showcase their work to show you how Neuroservices-Alliance can be your efficient CNS drug discovery partner. We know that your time is valuable, which is why our online events all follow today's format: 20-minute presentation followed by 10-minute questions and answer. If you have any question at any time, don't hesitate to submit them in the question box that is located on the bottom of the GoToWebinar panel. Your question will be answered right after the presentation. I would like to inform you that this session is recorded and you will receive the recording after the session. But of course, I strongly encourage you to stay until the end, as this is the occasion to have our speaker answer your questions live. Before starting, I would like to introduce Neuroservices-Alliance to those who don't know us. We are a consortium of CNS contract research organizations. Our team is specialized in vitro and in vivo electrophysiological and behavioral studies. Our goal is to deliver endpoints facilitating decision-making to our clients for their CNS drug discovery programs. We value direct and efficient interaction with our clients, and we rely on a team of more than 50 PhD scientists. As a speaker to address today's topic, we have Esther Steidl with us. Hello, Esther, and I will let you take the lead from here.
Thank you, Diane. Hi, everyone. I'm Esther Steidl. I'm the head of the MEA laboratory at Neuroservice since inception in 2006. I have 17 years of experience in the use of electrophysiological recordings, which I used first in a drug discovery company to help decision making and identifying the more relevant compounds to be developed. Next, I joined Neuroservice and I continue to specialize in the use of electrophysiology to accelerate CNS drug development. As a member of the contract research organization, I had the opportunity to work on compounds aimed to treat various pathologies and involving an extremely wide panel of targets. We have developed many assays to answer our client questions, and we have tested hundreds of different compounds over this 14-year period. Among those, we had a chance to evaluate compounds displaying very interesting profiles. But we also got disappointing results with compounds that were not as promising as our client expected. Anyway, all the experiences we had were a source of improvement, and I'm glad to share a bit of this experience with you today. In today's webinar, I will briefly explain why evaluating compounds on synaptic transmission and plasticity assays are valuable to make decisions about their further development. In addition, I will show why doing this with the multi electrode array technique is the best option in a majority of cases. Next, I will show you concrete example of experiment aiming to confirm the target of the developed compound. I will also show how you can evaluate the efficacy of your compound or rank a series of lead compounds to select the best one. Finally, I will illustrate that MEA assays of synaptic transmission and plasticity are particularly relevant to investigate the mechanism of action of your compound at the neuronal network level. The cost associated with a drug increases as it progresses throughout the R&D phases. It is then paramount to get predictive results to decide about pursuing the compound development further or to give it up. The assays of synaptic transmission and plasticity we provide are there to guide you in your research program. They are useful to evaluate your compounds from the lead optimization to the preclinical development phases. In addition, they are also of value to confirm the target engagement, as well as the signaling pathways or the mechanisms with which are at play. Neuronal network functions are reported to be impaired in a very wide range of CNS pathologies. This could result from a degeneration of some type of neurons or from changes in the synaptic transmission or plasticity in defined brain regions. For instance, it is documented that the excitation inhibition balance is impaired in the hippocampus of Alzheimer's disease patients. And the observed hyperexcitability is thought to be associated with a cognitive decline. Assays based on synaptic transmission and plasticity could be used to test if a compound is able to prevent a deficit triggered by the pathology or to compensate for the process which is altered. To ensure a proper functioning of the brain, neurons have to receive, integrate, and transmit the information from and to all those other neurons they are connected with. One specificity of neurons is they are electrogenic cells. They receive and transmit information through electrical signals that rely on the activation-deactivation of voltage and ligand-gated ion channel. Neurotransmitter release depends on the change of membrane potential arriving to the synapse as an action potential. In the postsynaptic neuron, the neurotransmitter release triggers a change of membrane potential, which can be recorded with an extracellular electrode. To be oversimplistic, in the case when a pathology alters the neuronal network function, it could be seen through the recording of electrical activity within this network, and on the opposite, if a compound restores normal neuronal properties, it's also possible to observe it through electrophysiological recordings. At Neuroservice, we record synaptic transmission and plasticity within brain or culture neurons, both with the patch clamp and the multi-electrode array technique. I will show you why mirror recording are often the best option to evaluate your compound, but I will first present this technique. As you can see what a MEA look like on the right picture. The bottom picture shows an example of hippocampal slice placed on the multi-electrode array. The electrode surrounded by a green circle is used to stimulate the axon of the C3 neurons, and the evoked responses recorded in the stratum radiatum of the CR1 region could be recorded at the electrode surrounded by the red frame. As you can see on the right panel, there are some examples of raw recording at MEA electrode at the 60 MEA electrode. Each signal recorded at each electrode corresponds to the summation of the excitatory postsynaptic potential, or EPSPs, occurring in a large population of neurons surrounding the recording electrode. Recording in hippocampal slices are often used to evaluate compounds, as this brain structure is very well known and as a large number of compounds target are present. However, synaptic transmission and plasticity could also be recorded from other brain regions, which display a well-defined organization, such as the cortex, the cerebellum, or the spinal cord. Why using MEA recording in acute brain slices is most of the time the best way to evaluate your compound on synaptic transmission or plasticity? First, as other ex vivo assays, it allows to evaluate your compound on native proteins expressed in a neuronal network which is mostly preserved in rodent brain slices. We are then very close to the in vivo situation. Sometimes we have tested compounds screened first on receptors expressed in recombinant system, and it happens that they are devoid of effect on the native receptor. When it's the case, it's crucial to know it as early as possible. In addition, as you can see on this illustration, the compound to evaluate is directly applied on the brain slice through a perfusion system. Thus, you can evaluate your compound knowing exactly at which concentration the target will be exposed. You do not need to determine first the pharmacodynamic and the pharmacokinetic of your compound. You can do it later if the results with this compound are satisfying. Why using the MEA technique is ideal to evaluate the effect of your compound on synaptic transmission and plasticity? First, the simultaneous multipoint recording provides information about the neuronal network functioning. It's like a wide-angle objective which allows to investigate the overall network activity. In addition, the simultaneous recording at multiple points within a brain slice allows to reveal region selective effect. It could bring insightful information to understand the compound mechanism of action and save time to document the compound's pharmacological profile, as several information could be obtained from a single experiment. Second, multipoint recording considerably increases the robustness of the results, as each electrode records and averages the signals from dozens of neurons, and as the data from several electrodes are averaged from each slice, it's possible to get very robust results from a limited number of samples. This involves that we could use a reduced number of animals and a low quantity of compound, and nevertheless get solid results, which represents an ethical and practical advantage. Third, as this technique is non-invasive, it makes the recording of synaptic transmission and plasticity over several hours feasible. It is very useful to evaluate a concentration range of compound on the same brain slice or to evaluate the effect of a compound on the late phase of LTP, which starts from 2 hours after the tetanus. Another strength of this assay is that synaptic transmission and plasticity could be modulated by an extremely wide panel of receptors, channels, enzymes, and transporters. You can see a few examples of compounds target we have investigated so far. Given our experience, we can advise you about the most relevant protocol and brain structure where to evaluate your compound. Also, we can often show you examples of reference compound effect in the specific assay we advise. In addition, evaluating your compound on a native neuronal network with MEA allows to detect off-target effects that could go unnoticed along the screening phases. Now, I will illustrate with concrete data why synaptic transmission and plasticity assays are particularly suited to confirm your compound's target and to document its pharmacological profile. I will also show this assay could be used to assess the potency or the efficacy of your compound or for the selection of the best compound among a short series of leads. Such assays could also be used to investigate the mechanism of action of your compound at the neuronal network level. Evaluate your compound on synaptic transmission or plasticity can be an ideal way to confirm its target in a native system. It's possible to investigate and document the properties of agonist, antagonist, or allosteric modulators of various receptors. It's also possible to confirm the activity of channel or enzyme modulators. Muscarinic agonists are known to inhibit synaptic transmission in the CR1 region of hippocampal slice. As an example, you can see that oxotremorine, a non-selective muscarinic receptor agonist, dose-dependently decreases the amplitude of EVOC responses. Given the effect of oxotremorine is quite rapid, it's possible to evaluate increasing concentrations cumulatively on a single slice and to build a concentration response curve. The EC50 of oxotremorine was determined at 92 nanomolar, whereas the EC30 was around 40 nanomolar. As the oxotremorine is a non-selective muscarinic receptor agonist, it is possible to determine which subtype of muscarinic receptors are involved in its effect on synaptic transmission. M1 and M4 are the main subtype of muscarinic receptors involved in the oxotremorine effect, as determined by the pre and co-application with the M1 antagonist pyrazepine and the M4 antagonist tropicamide. The contribution of M2 muscarinic receptors to oxotremorine effect is more modest. It is also possible to document the effect of allosteric modulators, when evaluating compounds on synaptic transmission or plasticity. For instance, VU10010, a positive allosteric modulator of M4 muscarinic receptors, is devoid of effect on EVOC responses in the CRN region when applied alone at 5 micromolar over a 40-minute period. However, it strongly enhances the effect of a low concentration of oxotremorine on synaptic transmission. Compounds modulating enzymes activity could also be evaluated on synaptic transmission and plasticity. Application of the cholinesterase inhibitor physostigmine caused a significant reduction of the field of PSPs elicited by a stimulation of the medial performance path within the hippocampus. Another advantage of MEA-based assay of synaptic transmission and plasticity is to select the best lead among a series of compounds. The graph presented here shows experiments which were performed to evaluate a series of positive allosteric modulators of metabotropic glutamate receptor of type 3. They were evaluated in the dendrogyrus of hippocampal slices on synaptic transmission at medial performance past synapses. As you can see on the left graph, the mGlu3 PAM was devoid of effect on synaptic transmission when applied alone over a 40-minute period. However, it largely enhanced the effect of a low concentration of LSP1-2111, which is a selective agonist for mGlu2 receptor here applied at its C20. You can see on the right bar graph that the effect of the mGlu3 agonist was very similar across the different experimental sessions. The reproducibility of the observed results is mandatory to accurately rank compounds by efficacy. Among the four compounds which were tested, only two actually behaved as a mGlu3 positive allosteric modulator, and the compound 3 was clearly more effective than the compound 1 to potentiate the LSP1 effect. Synaptic plasticity is the ability of synaptic connection between neurons to be strengthened or weakened. This process is central for the information processing within the brain of our cognitive function. Synaptic plasticity is reported to be altered in the case of several neurodegenerative diseases or also for psychiatric diseases, such as schizophrenia. It's possible to mimic such alteration in vitro, either by using rodent transgenic models of diseases which display an impaired LTP, or by altering synaptic plasticity with pharmacological agents such as MK801. Using these models, it's possible to evaluate the ability of compounds to restore a normal plasticity in a pathophysiological network and to compare their efficacy. You can see on the graph below that the potentiation triggered by a high-frequency stimulation is completely dependent on the extracellular magnesium concentration. In an extracellular medium containing 0.1 millimolar of magnesium or less, the LTP is almost abolished. It mimics, in some aspects, what occurs in Alzheimer's disease pathology, since amyloid peptide is reported to trigger an overactivation of NMDR receptors, which would be responsible for LTP impairment and cognitive dysfunctions. You better see on the left graph that in a medium containing 0.1 millimolar of magnesium, the LTP is largely impaired. However, if memantine, which is used to treat Alzheimer's patients, is added to the perfusion medium, the synaptic plasticity is restored close to the level observed in physiological condition in a medium containing 1.3 millimolar of magnesium. Another asset of MEA assays of synaptic transmission and plasticity consists in investigating the mechanism of action of a compound on the neuronal network activity. Multipoint recording over a large area of a neuronal network avoids missing the effect of the tested compound. Once an effect is observed, it is possible to progress step by step to delineate the compound's target and its mechanism of action. For this, different protocols could be used to determine if the effect of the compound is pre- or postsynaptic, if it modulates glutamatergic or GABAergic neurotransmission, etc. And by homology with already tested reference compounds, a restricted number of hypotheses could be drawn. And finally, selective agonists or antagonists could be used to confirm the compound target. As illustrated on the left graph, some compounds could display region selective effects, and MEA recordings allow to catch the different effects all at once with a single experiment. The effect of compound on population spike and field PSPs could be assessed in parallel and at multiple sites within the brain slice. For instance, in the nanomolar range, gabazine preferentially affects extrasynaptic GABA receptors expressed on interneurons. This leads to a disinhibition of the CR1 pyramidal neurons and causes an increase of the amplitude of the population spike in the stratum pyramidal. On the opposite, the amplitude of field PSPs recorded in the stratum radiatum is not modified by a low concentration of gabazine. Indeed, modulation of the field PSP amplitude rather revealed compound's effect on direct glutamatergic transmission between C3 and CR1 neurons. Why evaluating your compound at Neuroservice will make a difference in your study results? First, thanks to our expertise. Over 14 years, we have developed many types of assays in different brain regions, and we have tested hundreds of compounds. This provides an unparalleled experience about the effect of a wide range of compound classes and allow us to advise you with the more appropriate assay to perform. Second, we provide tailor-made and flexible study plan. Except if you already have a precise idea of the test you need to perform, at Neuroservice, we propose customized study plan for each client. We advise you about the assays that will bring you the most straightforward answer to your question, taking into account your time and budget constraints. We can build completely flexible study plans, including decision trees or multiple steps with go-no-go decision. In any case, if your compound doesn't display the expected effect, we immediately put the experiment on hold and we contact you so that you can decide to reorient the study plan or to stop the study. We really function as your remote laboratory. Third, the results provided by Neuroservice are especially robust. Over more than 14 years, we have constantly improved our processes to avoid any bias when evaluating compounds on main neuronal properties. We are working according to standard operating procedure, which ensure the reproducibility and the traceability of the results. In addition, the MEA technique with multi-point recordings contributes to increase the robustness of the results. Finally, we can perform your study with a short turnaround. With the MEA technique, as a large number of neurons are recorded along a single experiment, the number of samples can be modest and nevertheless provide robust results. With 9 rigs running in parallel, we have a large bandwidth and we can ensure rapid delivery of the study results. For a classical study, it takes about 2 weeks from the signature of the contract to the data release. I hope you are now convinced that synaptic transmission and plasticity assays based on MEA recording are ideal to help you in your decision to further continue your compound development by providing predictive results. Such assays are useful to confirm the target engagement and to document the pharmacological profile of a compound. They make the compound's triage easy and enable to elucidate the mechanism of action of a compound at the network level. The data we present today are far from exhaustive, although they were not shown in too detail, so do not hesitate to contact us for further information. Thank you for your attention. Diane, do we have some questions?
Thank you, Esther. Yes, we have a couple of questions. First, is it possible to record synaptic transmission from any brain region with MEA?
So actually, with a multi-electrode array technique, it's possible to record synaptic transmission or plasticity from all the brain region displaying a well-defined organization. So it is the case for the hippocampus, the cerebellum, the cortex, or the spinal cord. Indeed, neurons have to display the same orientation in regards to the electrode, so that the change in their membrane potential adds up rather than they cancel. So that's why it's the recording of synaptic transmission and plasticity with MEA are better adapted to brain structures that display a laminar organization. For other brain structure, the patch clamp experiments are more appropriate.
Okay, thank you. Next one. What MEA setup are you currently using in your facilities? What is your preferred electrode density?
Currently, we are using multi-channel system rigs, which are basically provide multi-points recording with MEA displaying 60 electrodes. But we have also tested the new CMOS system with a very high density of electrodes. And we made some trial with several type of brain slices, and we were very convinced of the advantage of the technique. So we will use it to develop new assay in the future.
Okay, thank you. Next one. Is it possible to evaluate multiple concentrations of compound on a single slice and multiple compounds on a single slice?
Yes, for sure. It's possible to evaluate multiple concentration of a compound on the same slice as far as the effect of the compound occurs within 20, 30 minutes or 40 at the maximum. And so we can apply compound from the lowest to the highest concentration and determine what is the effect of each concentration. Talking about evaluating several compounds on the same slice, so it's possible to evaluate two compounds along the same experiment to determine if there are some interaction between the two compounds.
Okay, thank you. Next, I understand this isn't the main utility of the system, but with MEA experiments, which are close to an intact system, can you actually detect changes in concentrations of neurotransmitters too?
No, it's not possible with the system we use. We can see that indirectly because if the quantity of neurotransmitter is modified, we will, as a consequence, we will observe different changes in the membrane potential of neurons. But we cannot measure that directly, not with the multi-electrode array we using now.
Okay, now, can you perform MEA studies in iPSC with MEA? And what is your experience with iPSCs and MEA compared to organ slices?
So, very good question. So, we have a very good lab in San Diego, which perform recording in human iPSCs derived neurons. And for now, it's a recording performed with patch clamp, but soon I think there will be also recordings performed with multi-electrode arrays. but I'm not more qualified to compare the slice and the iPSCs because I have not so much experience with iPSCs.
Okay, thank you, Esther. Last question I have for now is, what species are you working with? Only rodents or other species?
Okay, currently at Neuroservice in Aix-en-Provence, with the MEA technique, we work only from rodent brain slices, so which means rat and mouse. However, Neuroservice also provide recording in human brain slices from our lab in Bordeaux, thanks to a partnership with an hospital in Bordeaux. And as I said previously, we also provide recording in human iPSC derived neurons in our lab from San Diego.
Okay, thank you, Esther. Well, I think anyway, our time is over. So we will stop the question session here, but we will be in touch with you, and don't hesitate to send us your question should you have any more questions. Thank you for your attention. So the webinar is now over. You will soon receive an email with the full recording of this session. You can visit neuroservicesalliance.com to make sure you register for our next webinars. And also, after closing your GoToWebinar window just right now, a short survey will open in your browser. We appreciate your feedback. Thank you, and we look forward to seeing you at our next online events.